Discover a truly premium 100% electric drive. The new Nissan Ariya. Discover outstanding.
What's it all about? Why are we here? Is there a God? What happens when we die? In this series, I'm talking to public figures about these questions. Like me, none of them claims to be a religious expert, but all of them have, at times, had cause to think about the meaning of life. Hello again and welcome, and thank you for joining us. And our guest this time is Ben Dunne.
Hello, Gary.
Tell me about prayers in Cork and childhood and boyhood and all of that.
Yeah, I was born in Cork and went to school in Presentation Brothers in the Western Road. Was never a great lover of school, but never got into trouble. Took the odd day off and got away with it.
Many people would think that you had a sort of, that you must have had a privileged childhood and boyhood. Fair or not?
I would say we had a fairly normal, rather than privileged, childhood.
You are not flamboyant people.
No. My father was a man who respected a pound note right up to the day he died. He came from nothing. His mother, when she was dying, called him in, and the bank were going to make him bankrupt. And she was dying, and she said, "Would you ever pay this debt off?" And that gave him an incredible fear of banks, of owing the banks money. And I think he passed that on to his children as well.
Go back now. Did you leave after Intercert then?
I did.
You had enough.
Well, I had enough, and my father, I think, realised I had enough. So I left in fifth year and started work in the store.
So he encouraged you to leave, did he?
He did, no doubt about it. He knew that I didn't particularly like school and that I did like working in the shop, and I liked the idea of making money.
And you felt you were good at it?
I think he felt I had a fair enough eye for it.
He was an extraordinary man. He was also very religious.
Extremely. And on the Stations of the Cross every morning. Said the rosary every morning. I travelled with him and I missed flights with him where he would be on his knees saying the rosary.
Wherever he was?
Last thing at night and first thing in the morning.
On his knees?
On his knees. And as children, when he'd come home, it was we all said the rosary. But he didn't push religion down our throats, you know, as we grew up, left it to ourselves. But he never changed. His way was his rosary and then the Stations of the Cross.
I remember seeing him one day in White Friar Street Church.
That's correct.
Would your relationship have been such that you would have said to him, "Dad, what's all the Stations of the Cross business?"
No. The last 5 years of his life, I got very, very, very close to him. But it was nearly easier for me to call him chairman than dad.
Really?
Yeah, genuinely. I mean, I'd call him dad, but it was nearly unnatural. Now, I loved him as a father, but I really saw him as my boss. And I would have small chat with him and, you know, was able to have very open conversations with him. And there was nothing that I didn't discuss with him.
Because he died too soon for me, I never went for a drink with my father. I didn't have that relationship with him. Was there ever that relationship with you and your father?
No. His father died in the workhouse in Newry, and he had a dread of drink. I mean, an extraordinary fear of it, and rightly so, because of plenty of addiction in our family. But you respected that side of him. You wouldn't drink a pint in front of him.
Out of respect.
Absolutely out of respect.
You said about the addiction in your family. You reckon it's in your genes.
No question, I believe that, yeah.
Okay. Did he give you of his time as a father?
No, he was a very kind man.
I know that.
But I can't recall too many hugs from my dad. Now, that's not a criticism of him. That's just the way it was, because he wasn't around. You know, he was gone. He was working hard. But I have very fond memories of my childhood.
So now let's talk about Mum, Nora. She was religious too, of course.
My mother was religious. And she, I suppose I would say that my mother was the kind of peacemaker. In a family business, there's always different sorts of rows.
Squabbles.
Yeah. And I'd say she was the conduit. We all ran with her difficulties that we could be having with one another. And she kind of kept the peace, and no matter what was going on.
Now, your rows with the family have been well documented, and we're not going to go into all that again, except to ask, I have the impression that peace has broken out and the armistice has been signed.
For a long time.
Long time.
Long time.
Okay. But it's 30 years, next October, since you were kidnapped by the IRA. It suddenly occurred to me, did you ever meet any of these fellas again? Like, did any fella ever come up to you in the street and say, hello, Ben, you don't know me, but the last time we met, I had a balaclava and a gun. And
No. But I had a situation not too long ago where I had lunch with Gerry Adams and Martin McGuinness. And so, obviously, there was a bit of nervousness, and because of the history, their history and my history. And I said, now, lads, I said, if it's anything about money that this lunch is, I'll be looking for a refund. And in fairness to both Gerry and Martin McGuinness, they took it in the best of spirits.
Yeah. So well they might.
So well they might, is right.
Did you talk to the guys who kidnapped you?
I did. And some of them were more sympathetic to me than others. Some of them were ruthless. Some of them weren't quite so ruthless.
Were they masked all the time?
All the time. Except at night. Then they took the balaclava off me, and I laid me down on the bed, and they were wearing a balaclava.
What did you talk to them about?
Well, I quickly learned what not to talk to them about, because politics came up, and I quickly realised that their politics was completely different to mine. I believed in one thing, the ballot box only, but at this stage these guys believed in the ballot box or the gun. So I quickly changed my
tack.
I realised that I was in a really tight corner, and funnily enough, I think I spent more time talking to God.
Did you make promises to God at that time if you got out of it? Did you think you were going to die?
I knew there was a possibility, but I didn't think I was going to die. God was going to get rid of me this way. But I made no promises. I just said, like, why did you do this to me? What have I done to deserve this? And then I asked, give me one chance just to see my kids. And you know, it's extraordinary in life when you're in a tight corner like that. Even one glimpse, you'll say, look, just give me one glimpse and then do what you want.
One glimpse of your children?
Yeah, just to meet them, one hug. And now if you want to take me. But give me at least that chance.
Do I have a memory that your father, the chairman, had a bullet or two mounted on his desk, which were the bullets intended for you?
There was one intended for the priest, Dermot McCarthy. There was one for me. And I forget, they gave me three. And
they said, gave you these bullets?
Yeah, I said, no, just you remember this. You know, we know where you live. We know where you go to your kids go to school. We know this. So, you know, you just put one foot wrong, and we've got plenty more of these bullets.
And what do they mean by put one foot wrong? Do you mean tell the story, or?
Well, I had very little to tell because they were wearing balaclavas. But that's what they meant. And 30 years on, I still don't talk that much about it.
Do you forgive the guys who kidnapped you?
I forgive everybody. I don't know the people who kidnapped me. So how can I forgive them? But if I did know them and if I met them, I would forgive them, yeah.
So you don't consider the people who kidnapped you to be bad people? No?
What I would say is that, yes, there was good in those people.
There was badness too.
But yeah. There's badness. Look, people in glass houses can't throw stones. There was badness in me.
Look, do you think it was a result of that experience, Ben, and the terror and the fear, that what happened in Florida nearly 10 years later happened?
No.
No?
No. No, not in any way. Of course I could use it as an excuse, but it had nothing to do. Florida had nothing to do with me going off the rails. Two different...
Well, what had to do with that then? What was going on in your life at that time? And at the time of Florida, had you already been using regularly?
Oh, yeah, you mean Florida. Regularly. I was using. And to put it simply, I suppose you lose respect for God. You lose respect for your parents. It's a slow breakdown process. Then you lose respect for yourself. And once you lose respect, your standards drop. And I got to the stage where I had plenty of money. Didn't have to worry. If I wanted a new Mercedes, I just rang up the local dealer and say, send me one down. They're only small little things. But when I look back and see how the deterioration was setting in, it's extraordinary. And when you come out the other side, the way I have, thankfully, a more balanced person, you actually can look back and say, yeah, it's so easy to fall into this blooming trap.
There was a touch then that I have plenty of money, I'm God, I can do what I like.
There was more than a touch. Today, my brain thinks completely differently because in a lot of occasions, before I do something, I think of the consequences. In those days, I never thought about the consequences.
When you say you were using a long time before Florida, how did your friends not spot this? You had a number of very close pals.
Because I didn't use it in front of my friends. I was a secret user. Sometimes you might think you would have been better if you had used it openly, but you still had to hit your rock bottom. I still had to nearly kill myself and cripple myself. I had to hit my rock bottom, and that's the only way I would have got myself on the road to recovery.
You just narrowly escaped 3 years in jail.
By the luck of the man above looked after me. The police in Florida came into the room without a warrant. And if they had waited an hour or two, now the amount of cocaine that I had was more than possession. I would have been charged with distributing.
Dealing.
Or dealing. And that was mandatory 3 years. And the only thing that saved me was that they moved too quick.
So somebody was looking after you, you reckon?
Oh, yeah, my man above there who had been looking after me.
I think that when you came back that time, you pulled the greatest, most wonderful piece of PR ever. Because it seems to me that you went against what would have been the advice of any PR guy or any PR agency in this country. You told the truth. And you stood up and said, I take complete responsibility. It happened, I admit it, and I let my family down and my wife down and my people down and my acquaintances. And that killed the story stone dead.
But you see, you've really answered an awful lot of things there. That's why I never took on PR people, even when I was in Dunne's, because I would know the type of advice that you would be given. I remember somebody saying to me, well, you should say you can't remember everything. And this was in America, so-called smart operator. I said, you know, you're some idiot. If I can't remember everything, I said, now everything can be thrown at me. Now, I knew that I was caught and there was only one chance I had, and that was to come with my hands up and tell the truth. And I also knew that if I gave half the story and said nothing, we said that there was a woman involved, that the next thing they'd hear about that, and there were going to be another avalanche of police or pressmen. So I remember walking in home and Mary said, you know, be careful. And I said, look, I barely had time to say sorry to her on a one-to-one basis, because they were queuing up outside the gate and I felt terrible for my wife. And as you said, I told it, it's not how far you fall, it's how far you bounce back. I didn't realise how much further I was going to fall, but thankfully I did bounce back. And people say that that was a very courageous thing to do. But what other option had I?
Do you reckon you were addicted to cocaine?
Absolutely.
For how long did this go on, Ben?
I would say there was a period between the late 80s up to 94.
94, that's yeah. 2 years after. And what then brought about your recovery?
I got great. I was ordered into a clinic in Europe. And it was pointed out to me that if it wasn't treated, two out of three people who don't respond to treatment die within a 5 to 7 year period. And that shook me. During that period, one of my sisters died. Then another one of my sisters died. And they both were addicts. Immediately that thought came into my head, you know, our family could break the statistics, not 2 out of 3, it could be 3 out of 3. And I don't want to be that. Once that got into my head, it was so much easier to handle and stay on that road and just say, look, you know, there's more to life than a piece of cocaine.
There was other crazy stuff, of course, as well. Is the foot a legacy, the bad foot a legacy of all of that?
Oh, yeah. I crushed my heels into my ankles. Jumped off a wall, 7 foot. 16 stone. Yeah, thought I could fly and the jet engine wasn't working. I had a crash landing.
And you still have the legacy.
I think that that's the way the man above has given me. I don't go to any NA meetings or anything like that, because there's not a day that I wake up that I'm not reminded. Listen, that's what drugs have done to you.
Now, when you say advice at the time, was there any particular advice from a spiritual advisor or a therapist or whoever which really did the trick or turned your mind?
Yeah, there was about 3 or 4 people who just gave me unbelievable advice.
But what kind of advice was it?
Very hard to stomach, but fruitful advice. And they were very bitter pills to take.
And what had you to do?
I had to give up cocaine, and I had to give up working for my family. Now, nothing to do with my family. It was to do with me. And I want to stress that. And I'm not for one moment blaming my sister or my brother or anything like that. But I was told that.
But then was there another spiritual dimension to the advice apart from getting away from the family?
The only spiritual thing that happened to me was when I was in the matter, the priest arrived in, a man by the name of Damien. I'll tell you, he said, what I want you to do now. He said, I want you to take this white stuff because it might help you to get off the bad white stuff. He was talking about the Blessed Sacrament. That's extraordinary. That registered with me. Now, not that I go to Mass every day of the week or anything like that. But at the time, it's like the two out of three die. There are things that register in your brain which have a profound effect on you. It just happened at the right time. Maybe if it was a week later, it would have had no effect. God knows.
Then after all of that, eventually came the tribunals, and I don't want to go into that in detail at all. I just want to ask you, did you say in an interview that you felt that you were a right idiot to give away all that money and get involved in all of that?
I may have. I mean, that's the way I would think today.
Is it?
Yeah.
A right idiot.
Complete idiot. I mean, it shows. Like, I was nuts, definitely, for a period of time. I would say I was just mad. I mean, and I can't blame anybody. I mean, there were loads of people approaching me to do this and do that. At the end of the day, the decision was mine.
Were you in awe of Mr. Haughey?
Definitely. I don't know what I saw in Haughey, but I was... Well, I was in awe of him, which is an extraordinary thing to say. And I never looked at Haughey's weaknesses. They never crossed my mind as being weaknesses.
And it cost you a lot of money.
Yeah, but sure, money is like manure. It's no good unless you spread it around.
No good unless you spread it around. That's okay. Yeah, all right. You said it.
Yeah, I don't in any way want... That's a comment I made. The tribunals have to make their findings.
Mary. Tell me about Mary the Rock.
She's a very private person. She's an extraordinary good wife. A more extraordinary mother. And a more extraordinary person beyond that. And... That's all I'm going to say about her.
Do you believe that there are secrets that husbands and wives can have from each other?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I believe, yeah, there must be a few secrets. Like, sometimes it's better off not knowing things.
I think wives have a better appreciation of that than husbands have.
But you see, we're two...
I mean, not knowing.
Well, we're two men, and remember this. We think completely different to women.
Oh, you found that out, have you?
I know that for a long, long time. Very much so.
How important is money to you?
Far less important than it used to be. In fact, I have a saying, loss of money, nothing lost. Loss of health, much lost.
And loss of honour?
Oh, everything gone.
Is it easier to say that now when you do have money?
No.
And how would you know anyway?
I know. Believe me, I know how money can destroy you.
Well, I've always believed that there is a thing called money madness.
I was worse than money madness. I mean, I was nearly dead. Like, it's only by the luck of God that I didn't kill myself when I jumped off that wall. It's by the luck of God that I didn't get 3 years in jail. Like, I think money is a very dangerous thing.
How strong a Catholic are you? And do you, by which I mean, you don't say the Stations of the Cross like your father used to do.
No.
You don't say the Daily Rosary like your father used to do, I presume. But you go to Mass.
I go to Mass intermittently. I'd never miss Mass on Christmas Day, Easter Sunday. I'd be I am a good Christian. I'd be a bad Catholic. But I believe that you're put down here to do something. Every one of us that are put on earth here, I think, are put here to do something. We're not put here just to do nothing.
Are you afraid of dying?
No. Why should you be?
You've been near it a few times.
But it's going to happen to me anyway, so I've accepted it.
And do you lay any store by the admonition of Jesus that it's easier for a camel to get through the da-di-da-di-da-di-da than a rich man?
No.
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 Doesn't worry.
No. May he have no interest in money, God. You can't buy your way in there. You can't bring it with you. So you might as well do something with it when you have it. Down here. That's my belief.
Who was Jesus to you?
He's somebody who I can feel that I can contact.
Do you believe he was God?
I believe he is God, yeah. You meet people today that say there is no God. I'm one of the people who say there is. But when you analyse it very simply, it's 50-50. There is or there isn't. Now, my mind would say, aren't you far better off believing that there is a God than saying, no, there is no God, I'm an atheist, and you arrive up at the gates of heaven and you're turned away. Or if I arrive at the gates of heaven, which I hope I will, I'll be welcomed maybe with open arms and forget about the eye of the needle and the money and all the other things. Far more important to believe in them.
Okay, final question. When you get up there, suppose it's all true, everything that you were taught all those years ago in Prez, and he is waiting there to greet you, what will you say to God?
I've been dying to see you.
Welcome. Thank you.
Okay.